or how to fight wars. So he had already bought into this idea that the Air Force was pushing. He liked the idea because it would allow him to carry out a war of regime change, which he'd already bought into. And by the way, it wasn't just the neoconservatives. It wasn't just pro-Israeli neoconservatives. It was the political elite, so the pro-military political elite and the national security elite generally, who believed that eventually the United States would have to overthrow the Saddam Hussein regime in Iraq. It was taken for granted widely in the political and national security elite in the 1990s. Because the United States was already virtually at war with the Saddam Hussein regime, had been since the US imposed a no-fly zone on northern Iraq in 1991, a few weeks, after the end of that war in Kuwait, defeat of Saddam's troops. So he wanted to have that war for regime change on the Air Force terms, in part because he could do it without using Air Force troops. And not only that, he could cut the Air Force budget significantly and use the money that he saved to spend on high-tech space weaponry, which was one of the things that the Air Force was putting in his head that was needed by the United States. So it fit into his idea of what the Pentagon should do in the future. It was part of a wider set of interests that particularly the Air Force had embraced, but they got their Secretary of Defense who would support their institutional interests. So my argument is that the Iraq War is really a function of the institutional interests of the Air Force prevailing in this struggle within the military institutions, the military bureaucracies, with the help of the Secretary of Defense, who they had already gotten to. They'd already enlisted him in their cause. He had become part of the Air Force institutional base of political interest. So those three wars, those three terrible wars, disastrous wars for the United States, I would argue, the evidence is very clear, are all wars that were essentially fought because of the institutional interests of these powerful bureaucracies. There's a different storyline in each case, but it's a common underlying explanation. Now let's talk about Afghanistan for a moment. Of course, Afghanistan is different in the following sense, that this was a decision made by George W. Bush in the immediate aftermath of the 9/11 attacks, September 11, 2001. This was a war, clearly, that was a product of public opinion, or at least the response to public opinion, to the cast of mind that the public opinion represented about doing something to get back at the people who perpetrated this attack on the American people. And going into Afghanistan was the easiest thing to explain, the most obvious move that he could make in the short run. What he did was to send in air power and special forces. And it was all arranged within a matter of weeks and carried out, started within a few weeks, as I recall, by early October, was already underway. Late September, I think the end of September, early October was already underway. So the war itself, I am not going to try to explain. The beginning of the war was not, in the sense that I've described it, a war that was a result of institutional interests, of the war machine, if you will. But what happened after that is very important to understand. Originally, the Taliban government was overthrown, had to flee the country. This was as a result of U.S. bombing, very weak military that the Taliban had was in no condition to try to withstand the military pressure. And so very quickly, they gave up and left the country. And in fact, many of the Taliban officials were ready to cooperate with a new administration after the war had ended. And a new administration was set up by the United States government, with the help, by the way, of Iran. Very important assistance that they gave us in setting up a new government in Afghanistan. But the United States refused to cooperate, to have anything to do with these Taliban officials who offered their cooperation, and was threatening to, you know, basically throw them all in jail. So they all fled to Pakistan. And from Pakistan, after a while, they realized that this new government was extremely unpopular. And by 2003, 2004, they were beginning to infiltrate back in to Afghanistan to make contact with their old friends and neighbors, and to establish political and military units, which then became the basis for a new war in Afghanistan, a new insurgency in Afghanistan. Very quickly, that insurgency succeeded in gaining territory and wresting control of large parts of southern Afghanistan from the government. So by 2005, the situation had become fairly serious. And at that point, the U.S. military, the U.S. Army, which was had sent more troops into Afghanistan, was saying, we've got an emergency on our hands. We've got to have a big infusion of more troops into Afghanistan. At that point, the war was turned over to NATO officially. NATO, North Atlantic Treaty Organization, which went back to the beginning of the Cold War, didn't have any function, didn't have any reason for being after the end of the Cold War, and they were desperate for a war that they could call their own. So, anyway, they were officially given responsibility for the war in Afghanistan, even though they had no idea what they were doing. And many of the military officers who were on the ground in Afghanistan, when the decision was made officially to say, okay, this is a NATO-run war now, were aghast at this and really felt very, very angry at the Pentagon for having made that decision, as a kind of a bone to throw to NATO, not for any good military reason. So as a result of the lack of any real strategy that had any chance of success, the Taliban continued to gain ground from 2005 until 2009. And by 2009, when Obama came into the Oval Office, the situation was truly desperate. They knew they were losing the war. The Taliban were very rapidly moving towards a situation where they were going to be able to win the war. So this was the point where the military bureaucracy put very strong pressure on Obama to escalate that war. And that is a situation that I find, and at the time found, very reminiscent of the pressure that was put on Lyndon Johnson to escalate the war in Vietnam. We already had, 18,000 troops / advisors, and the military wanted tens of thousands of more troops immediately, with more to follow after that. Well, in this case, as I recall, 12,000 troops, and they wanted another 40,000 troops with more to follow. So the parallel is really quite strong between Vietnam, the escalation of Vietnam in 1965, and the escalation in Afghanistan in 2009. And the parallel is further enhanced by the fact that Obama clearly did not want to do this. He believed that it would be a big mistake. And he said so, and we know that because there's a book that quotes from the National Security Council notes that were handed over to Bob Woodward, the journalist who writes books based on notes that people who were involved in various meetings hand over to him. And the notes show that Obama said, no, our interests are not in Afghanistan, they're in Pakistan. We do have vital interest in Pakistan, but not in Afghanistan. He made that argument very explicitly in the meetings. And what did the military and the Pentagon, the Secretary of Defense, and the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, were pushing very hard for this escalation do? They went to the media and they badmouthed Obama. They planted a story that said, well, basically, they got one particular news service, McClatchy News Service, to interview something like two dozen military, intelligence, and State Department officials about their view of the Obama administration's policy. And of course, surprise, surprise, they all said, oh, Obama's making a big mistake. He's not taking seriously the threat from Al-Qaeda to return to Afghanistan. And so that was the piece that was published by McClatchy News Service, bad-mouthing Obama's policy. That was a signal, that was a shot across the bow to Obama, that if you don't agree to the additional troops that are being requested by the commander in Afghanistan, we will have ways to show that you're responsible for a threat to U.S. security from Al-Qaeda. Now, the reality was that the Taliban never would have allowed Al-Qaeda to come back into Afghanistan, because when Al-Qaeda carried out that 9/11 attack, it was absolutely against the explicit orders, the explicit insistence by Mullah Omar, the head of the Taliban in Afghanistan, to Osama bin Laden, don't you dare carry out a terrorist attack from our soil. We will not allow you to do that. He lied to them and said he would not do it. Then he went ahead and did it. So the Taliban had no use for bin Laden at all. They held it against him. And there's a lot of evidence that there was bad blood between the two. And so the Pentagon, the Joint Chiefs, were simply lying about this to put pressure on Obama to agree to it. Obama did cave in, just as LBJ caved in, and went along with the demand for escalation. So four wars, or escalations of war, that I would argue are the result directly of the institutional interests of these powerful bureaucracies. That is the basic case that I want to make, that what we have here is a permanent war state that threatens the interests of the American people in ways that we are now beginning to understand more and more with every passing year. And so I am now working on a book which I plan to call Against the Permanent War State, which will make this argument that we are up against a set of institutions who have been getting their way for so long, for many decades now, and who are so powerful that they represent a threat to the very integrity of the democratic system of the United States. And that it is a vital interest of the United States that the American people organize themselves, organize a movement, a citizens' movement, to not just push back against the existing wars, but to get this system under control once and for all by having Congress pass a piece of legislation that will legally prohibit these kinds of wars of intervention. Wars of choice, they are called often in the political parlance of national security, that will spell out the limitations, the strict limitations on the kinds of military plans that can be made, the kinds of preparations for war that can be made, the kind of military bases that can be maintained, and the kind of military forces that can be used, and which will essentially roll back what I call the permanent war state into the status of a normal state. The state that existed when Eisenhower took over as president, and which he maintained to a great extent during his 8 years in the presidency. Eisenhower would not let, and here I'm now putting a codicil or an asterisk here, which is a partial exception to the generalization I've made. Dwight Eisenhower as president would not let this set of institutions have their way. He would not let the army in particular get the means by which they could prepare for wars on the periphery of China and Russia, as they were demanded that he do during the 1950s. They wanted to have a whole new military strategy that would consist of the United States being prepared to go to war in places like Pakistan and the Central Asia and Southeast Asia, all the places which are unstable and which they argue the Chinese and the Russians are threatening through their contacts and their support for communist movements or radical movements, none of which was really true. Eisenhower said no. And he also prevented the Navy from doing what they wanted to do, which was to really go to war against China. Throughout the 1950s, when there were a series of crises over the Taiwan Straits, where the Chinese were saying that they wanted to take back, or it seemed like they wanted to take back the island of Taiwan, the Navy and the Air Force were both pushing for war. Same thing happened in 1953 when the French were on their last legs. And there was a crisis over possible defeat of the French, which was believed to be a potential war ender, probably a war ender. And the Navy through the Chief of Staff, who was the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, was one of those naval admirals who wanted to go to war for years against China. And so they seized that opportunity to try to push for war, which could include war against China. So Eisenhower said no. And the Air Force and the Army in particular were so angry with Eisenhower that they went to the press and accused Eisenhower of being soft on the Soviet Union, soft on communism, because he would not agree to the programs that they were demanding, both for strategic bombers and missiles and for conventional forces that the Army wanted in the periphery around the Soviet Union and China. So again, we have a situation where these institutions were using their tremendous political power, their ties with the media as well as with Congress. They also went to key Democratic senators and told the senators that Eisenhower was not doing what was necessary. Of course, they began with the senator who represented Boeing aircraft in the state of Washington, who was very, very much in sympathy with their views, but they also went to other senators as well. This is the kind of political maneuvering that these institutions are accustomed to using. And this is why one president after another has been, to one degree or another, intimidated by this concatenation of this combination of institutions. And that is the case right down to the present day. Today we see some of the same thing going on even with the Trump administration. Now it's the intelligence community under the Obama administration who are leaking these ideas that Trump's aides were colluding with the Russians. I'm writing a 4,000-word piece right now which completely explodes that whole myth, that whole set of stories about the alleged collusion, the leaks about the alleged collusion between Trump aides and the Russians. So that's just the latest installment of the larger storyline of how these institutions have tried to use and have been very successful in using pressure tactics to get their way. I'm going to stop there, if I may, and ask for your comments or questions, and we'll go from there.
My question was originally going to be about the effect that the military corporations that produce the weapons, the role that they play in all of this. And I was wondering why you hadn't said anything about it, but you did mention Boeing just now.
Yeah, you're right, Paul. And the reason is that I have sort of gone off in one direction about the themes of my book. Which is precisely that theme of how these bureaucracies have steered the United States into a series of disastrous wars. But you're right, of course, there's a separate theme, which is how these institutions are joined at the hip with private military contractors who stand to gain the most directly from these wars and from the preparation for war. And that, of course, is why you've had, since the end of the Eisenhower administration, the term the military-industrial complex. It's a term that you don't hear very much. Eisenhower uttered those words, that term, in his farewell address in January of 1961. And it attracted quite a bit of notice at the time because he had never said anything about this publicly. We now understand that he said that because he really hated these people who had attacked him, who had used dirty tactics to attack him for being soft when they knew the truth was simply otherwise. But what he meant by that was, of course, that there was this, and by the way, Eisenhower initially intended to call it the military-industrial-congressional complex because he knew that the third point of the triangle was Congress, because both the military and the contractors, the private contractors, were also in league with powerful members of Congress who had also political interest, vested interests, in continuing this system the way it was, because they were getting lucrative contracts in their districts or in their state, and of course getting major donations from the contractors that helped them to be reelected. So that was the system that Eisenhower was talking about. And what I will talk about in my book is how this system, this triangular system, has now morphed into something quite different. In some ways it's the same, but what we've seen since 9/11 is an accelerating trend toward the merger of the private sector contracting firms and the state bureaucracies, both in the military sector and in the intelligence sector. What does that mean? It means that there's several aspects of it. More and more of the actual work in both the Pentagon, the Armed Services, and the CIA, and the National Security Agency, is being done in the building or outside the building by the contractors. In other words, they are making more and more of the substantive decisions, doing more and more of the substantive work of these institutions than ever before, and doing it more directly. And that's in part because the Bush administration and the Obama administration have chosen to go along with a system which gives the contractors more and more of the work in order to say that this is not being this is not part of the it's not reflected in the budgets of the CIA directly. It's, of course, they get the money, but the CIA bureaucracy itself is not getting the money. It's going to the these private sector individuals and firms. But more importantly than this, you have a situation where the revolving door between these administrative organs, these state organs, and the private contractors has been going faster and faster. A book published a few years ago by Washington Post correspondent, two Washington Post correspondents, about the secret America, found that, and this was published, if I remember correctly, in 2013 or 2014, they found that six different top-level officials of the CIA, NSA, and the Pentagon had gone from the Bush administration directly into senior positions in the private sector related to their bureaucracies. And that meant that these people who were obviously already in touch with these private sector entities were making decisions at some point in their careers, in their service under the Bush administration, which they knew was going to be profiting these kinds of contractors. So what we have here is a phenomenon of not just institutional interests being served by this system, but increasingly the policymakers, the decision makers in the institutions, making decisions knowing that they're going to be enriching themselves. They are going to be setting themselves up for extremely lucrative contracts or jobs that depend on those contracts in the private sector. And so that's why I argue that what we have now is not just a complex that involves a triangle. What we now have is a new kind of entity, which is a merger of the private sector and the public sector. This is no longer, strictly speaking, just a public sector, a state bureaucracy. And it is more, in fact, and this has been observed not by radical opponents of the system, but by people who are within the system, that this concatenation of institutions more and more resembles a business rather than a public service. And so that is going to be one of the themes that I will develop in my book, that the permanent war state is now not truly a public service institution in the sense that it is even theoretically now representing the interests of the public, but resembles more a private business that makes decisions on the basis of the combination of institutional business interests, quote unquote, and private business interests that will in fact enrich the decision makers of those organs of the state. That's a new situation, and to my mind, this represents a scandal that goes beyond anything that we've ever seen in the past. I mean, we've known all along that people are enriching themselves on the basis of the war state, or the permanent war state. But now I think we have a situation where you can document very credibly the reality that they're making decisions for war, making decisions preparation for war, making decisions on what to spend money on and how much money to spend, which are reflections of their own self-interest as well. And so I'm ready to say that this is not just a business-like arrangement, but a racket. Some of you know that General Smedley Butler, the most decorated Marine of his time in the 1920s and early 1930s, wrote a book in which he attacked the war profiteers and the military who had been serving them as saying, "War is a racket." That was the name of his book, "War is a Racket." I was toyed with the idea of saying national security is a racket. But in any case, I think that it is a fair statement to make that this whole system now is indeed a racket. And it needs to be analyzed and it needs to be called for what it is. Yes, please.
I think you present a very good case of how this permanent economy develops. Now, at the moment, for example, if the president is elected, he has to choose people for his teams. And the way the people are chosen have to come from this institution, because he cannot choose people who are outside of it or against his interest. And so, you know, that's the way it is, and how could you get out of it?
It's a very important point, of course. I'm not using my system here. It's a very important point, one that I have thought about a lot. It is the reason that we've had so much, that so many presidents have been vulnerable to, or have been so vulnerable to the pressures of these institutions, because they end up surrounding themselves with advisors, quote unquote, who are representing in one way or another, directly or indirectly, the interests of this permanent war state. And if you go back over the history of one presidency after another, it's the same theme over and over again. Every president has ended up, as you've said, drawing his national security team from the history, the institutions that have those self-interests. Either still, in the service of those institutions, or more often, people who have retired at some point, but the president brings them back into service in his administration. We know, that, for example, John F. Kennedy chose Dean Rusk as his Secretary of State. Because he represented, he was sort of somebody who represented that whole cast of characters who had been in the national security institutions during the 1950s. He had been in the State Department. He was a hawk. Everybody knew he was a hawk. And so he represented a point of view that legitimized John F. Kennedy by choosing a Secretary of State. He didn't have to worry about being criticized because he chose somebody who was sort of legitimate in terms of that whole universe. Obama, of course, did the same thing. I mean, he went one step further, chose a Republican, somebody who had served Republican administrations as his Secretary of Defense, Robert M. Gates. He'd been CIA director under Republican administration. And have then been Secretary of Defense under George W. Bush. And he was doing so to prove his bona fides that he was going to be tough on national security. It was like almost a Pavlovian response to becoming the President of the United States, to show that he cannot be criticized or attacked because he has people who are fully legitimate in terms of their national security credentials. But that does, in effect, set up this dynamic constantly. Now, Trump is rather interesting in this regard because, he has flouted the tradition in terms of the National Security Council by his insistence that he bring in these advisors who have no credentials whatsoever, exactly the opposite. And that has enraged of course, the national security elite as well as the political elite. And the argument is being made that, that this is against the national interest, it's very dangerous, and so on and so forth. But it is really the first time that I can recall anything like that ever happened, where a president has essentially acted in the face of the norms that are expected of a president. And even then, of course, he's still choosing people for the major national security positions who are, meet that description more or less, of people who have those acceptable credentials. And of course, he's gone overboard with military people more than other presidents. Yes, please.
Hi, I really would like to get your read on Donald Trump and how he's going to play in all this. You sound actually a little bit supportive of him. given that you cited him as saying that the Iraq war was a disaster, but anything that doesn't involve Donald Trump is considered a disaster. But he also said we should take the oil. And he says maybe we'll go back and take the oil.
I'm not going to say anything in defense of Donald Trump as a president or as a human being. I mean, I think he's a disaster as a generality. I have no bones about that. He's going to create enormous troubles for this country for however long he's president. No question about that. At the same time, I mean, it is true that he is dissenting from some of the positions that have been held both by Bush and by Obama, positions that both presidents have advanced with regard to the Middle East in particular. I mean, he's staked out a position on Syria, which apparently, and I think it's become pretty clear now that he doesn't intend to support the position that Obama